Welcome to the city of Birmingham, the heart of the country, the heart of the motor industry, and believe it or not, with more canals than Venice. This year, it's host to the Network Q RAC Rally, the final round of the World Rally Championship.
Four, 3, 2, 1.
It's 15 years since the rally last came to Birmingham, and as you can see, the city's skyline has changed dramatically since then, including the building of this, the new National Indoor Arena. And it's here that the Network Q RAC Rally will be based for the next 4 days, and from where we'll be reporting on all the action. Scrutineering's been going on here since early morning on the cars taking part in Britain's biggest spectator sporting event. World champion Juha Kankkonen leads the field, which reads like a who's who of rallying, with drivers like François Delacour and Ari Vatanen joining Britain's great hope and Subaru teammate Colin McRae. From the start here in Birmingham at 7:30 tomorrow morning, the cars travel in a long loop round the Midlands, taking in the classic spectator stages, including a new one at Tatton Park near Manchester. Day two has an early drive out to the Welsh Forest for 10 gruelling stages over nearly 120 special stage miles before overnighting in Lancaster. Day three, Tuesday, and more fun in the treacherous Lake District, where many rallies have been won and lost. Get through here and you might see the end of the event. The final day sees the survivors head south back to Birmingham for an early evening finish in the city's Centenary Square. It's also the end of this year's rallying season, a series that's seen Toyota win their first manufacturers' championship.
Finland's Juha Kankkonen earned himself a special place in rally history this year, taking the World Drivers' Championship for an amazing fourth time. Still only 34, he won in Kenya, Argentina, Finland, and Australia, where he handed Toyota their first ever manufacturer's crown, just to complete the set. He had two main co-drivers. Sadly, Juha Pirinen had to retire through ill health, leaving 32-year-old Welshman Nicky Griss to make a winning debut in Argentina. The new pairing wrapped up the championship with a third place in the Catalunya rally in Spain, and they celebrated in traditional fashion. How many more titles can this amazing Finn win? He certainly runs circles round the opposition.
Frenchman François Delacour was Kankkonen's main rival and, to Ford's delight, actually led the championship for much of the season. He gave Ford their first win for 5 years in Portugal and added Corsica and Catalunya to his tally. This has been a fabulous debut year for the Ford Escort, bringing back memories of their supremacy in the 70s. 31-year-old François is one of the newest stars in rallying. He was considered to be a tarmac specialist, but has proved he can scatter the stones with the best of them.
Sweden's Kenneth Eriksson is Mitsubishi's number one driver, but the new Lancer Evolution is taking longer to evolve than the team expected. He perhaps raised hopes too high with his fourth place in Monte Carlo. But the team has been putting in a phenomenal amount of testing for this event. And we must never forget that Eriksson has twice finished second here on the RAC. Can he go on better and surprise everyone?
Finland's finest rallying ambassador must be Ari Vatanen. The 41-year-old hasn't slowed down since he arrived in Britain 20 years ago. In August this year, he took the new Subaru Impreza to a second place on its first outing, the Thousand Lakes. Ari's famous and flamboyant driving style will certainly please his thousands of British fans, who'd love him to go one better than his second place on last year's RAC. What a popular win that would be.
Another French ace, Didier Auriol, who started the year in superlative style following his transfer from Lancia to Toyota. He soon gave his new team something to cheer about, with an amazing victory on his home roads of Monte Carlo. Over the final night stages, he snatched a sensational win from Delagor's escort with some blistering times.
Germany's top rally driver is Armin Schwartz, hoping to emulate the feats of his fellow countryman, twice champion, Walter Rohr. Armin has already given the new Lancer its best result to date, finishing third in the Acropolis rally. It's only 5 years since he came to the RAC rally for the first time and finished fifth in his privateer Audi. Mitsubishi was the first Japanese car to win the RAC rally 4 years ago and is due for another taste of the champagne.
So the overseas drivers again expected to do well here, but Britain's Colin McRae has certainly set the alarm bells ringing after another impressive season. He's led the rally in the last 2 years, only to crash out and retire and then have mechanical problems. This time, he's doubly determined.
Colin McRae's New Zealand drive was quite brilliant, so great things are expected of him here.
I think there may be even be more pressure this year because I've won one now. So everyone will expect me to get out there and it won't be a problem. But it's just the competition now is just so close and it's seconds that we're fighting over, and as soon as you make one small mistake that you can lose out. So it's going to be fairly difficult, and I'm sure everyone else is probably thinking I'm going to be that quick, so they'll just be going even quicker to try and beat me in my home ground.
His approach to the RAC is fairly simplistic.
I'm going to get out there and I'm sure we're going to have the speed to win the event. And we just have to get it all right on the day, and I'm just going to go as quick as I can.
This will be the British debut of the Subaru Impreza, a car he certainly seems to like.
And it's a smaller car, so...
It's a smaller car, so maybe we won't knock so many corners off it.
For the drivers here in Birmingham, it's been a tense day as their cars are rigorously checked over in scrutineering. As usual, Tony Mason is our man with the microphone.
So, Ari, here again, last year a second place. Can you do one better this time?
I definitely will try. It would be something I personally and selfishly feel long overdue. So, and we have got, I think I'm in a good shape. I have a long last, I think, some maturity in my driving, and speed hasn't disappeared yet. And Subaru, the new Subaru is really fantastic. It's like a piece of sweet, so we go for it.
For this event, I would like snow also because I think it's better for me. I don't know the road enough. And when it's like that, I think everybody is going a little bit slower, then it's not so important to know the road very well. The reason why I would like snow.
He says it's one of his favourite events and he's hoping for snow.
Well, he's welcome to it, but I'm not, I can tell you that. I'd just be happy for the weather to stay dry for a change. And really, just let's have some consistent rally conditions so that you can really, you know, drive at 100%.
I preferred a rally like it was when I came here the first year without a practice, because then it was really a driving rally for the driver. Now you could have a good advantage if you're here every year and you could, I mean, modify your notes, develop your notes, you know the stages better. But before it was for everyone the same. It wasn't so fast because you never know what's happened after the crest. Now you know it's flat and it's much faster now.
Now tell me honestly, when you get into the Welsh sections, which you obviously know better than anywhere, I mean, do you drive in a different way? How do you feel?
Well, judging by the last couple of years I've been, I haven't been driving that well through there. But equally on the British Championship, we went very well through Wales. So I don't think I've got an omen there.
What do you think of the first day of this event?
It's probably one of the most difficult days. It's very easy to lose an awful lot of time on the stages without going too far wrong. So it's one of the most trickiest, but obviously very important for reseeding at the end of the first day.
Now the championship is really over now. So will you drive in a different way for this last rally, the Network Q RAC?
We don't know yet. Too depends feeling. If we are feeling sure, we have nothing to lose, and if we are not. Good feeling, we say okay, it's the last rally of the season, so keep the power for next year.
Just an easy run round on this one, is it?
Yeah, but it's not so easy, this rally. I think it's the second difficult rally in the championship after Monte Carlo.
You've got great opposition, of course, from our own Colin McRae. What do you think of Colin's driving?
No, for sure, if he can manage to stay on the road, he will be very fast.
David, how are you looking forward to this one?
Very much so. We've had a good recce over the last 7 or 8 days. Had a look around all the stages. Stages throughout the country are really in very, very good condition. But of course, what's the weather going to do in Jack Frost and snow? We're not sure. So fingers crossed the weather won't be too severe.
There's a new and controversial development to this year's rally. For the first time, there's a Formula 2 category for front-wheel drive vehicles. It's very much a testing ground for the big manufacturers who don't get much of a look in a sport dominated by four-wheel drive supercars. However, one manufacturer that's invested in Formula 2 has got off to a head start.
It's a year since Vauxhall unveiled their new Astra to the rallying world in the British Championship this year. In the hands of the experienced David Llewellyn, the car has proved highly competitive. What's more, it's shown its reliability too, failing to finish in only one of the 5 rounds. Vauxhall obviously have high hopes for its new rallying baby in what is the up-and-coming rallying category.
Formula 2 is set to become a very important part of the World Championship scene, and again you'll find manufacturers that like Renault and Citroën and maybe ourselves as well, who would be at World Championship level with the Formula 2 cars.
Other manufacturers are also showing their hand. Nissan recently tested its new Sunny and will be competing in this category for the first time. Gregoire de Mavius, the young Belgian and reigning Group N world champion, is just about getting the feel of his new car.
It's a good car to make a Formula 2. Of course, we arrive a bit late and the others, some others are there from a long time, so we have to work, but I think if we give us some more time, I think it will be a very good car.
For the driver, it's a whole new ball game.
The technique is quite different because sometimes with the two-wheel drive, I continue to push on the left foot even when the corner is finished, just to avoid the wheel spinning and to find the grip. So that's the thing you never do with a four-wheel drive, because you just go full throttle, and because you have four-wheel drive, you just go. What is very good with the Formula 2 is it's a proper rally car, so you can drive 100%. You don't have to take care of the car. It's strong, and it's made for that, so you go flat out. And when I was doing Group N World Championship, you always have to think, oh, maybe it's something gonna broke. So this is much different for us.
An unexpected convert to the new two-wheel drive club is the veteran and 5 times British champion, Jimmy McRae, in the new Volkswagen Golf GTI. He's found it much to his liking.
I was actually pleasantly surprised with the Volkswagen. I had a bit misgivings about it because it's years and years since I've driven front-wheel drive, and having sat beside my 2 sons in a Nova in test sessions, I wondered if I was up to it, but the car's going very well, and I was quite pleased with the performance and the way the car's working. I think it's much easier coming from a four-wheel drive to front-wheel drive. I think it would have been very difficult in the days when I drove rear-wheel drive only to come front-wheel drive, but once you've driven the four-wheel drive, and, you know, get left foot technique, it didn't feel so bad there.
Family rivalry then for father Jimmy and sons Colin and Alistair in the Subaru. So can dad catch them?
Well, if I had been driving the same cars that they're driving, then I think they would really be worried. But seeing as I'm in a 2-litre two-wheel drive car, they're not worrying so much about me.
A new category in this year's rally, and if you'd like to win a road-going version of one of those cars, we have our usual competition for you. The car at stake is a showroom version of David Llewellyn's car, and all you have to do is answer a simple question. In 1967, the RAC rally was cancelled. Was it because of a fuel shortage, lack of entries, or foot and mouth disease? All you need to do to enter is ring 0891 339966. That's 0891 339966.
And if you're not lucky enough to win the car, there are 10 copies of this rally, the video game of the Network Q RAC Rally, for the runners-up. And one man who won't be able to play with his computer over the next 4 days is Richard Burns, the current British champion, and he's one of a group of Britons in this event.
The last time we saw Richard Burns, he was celebrating his British Championship triumph after winning in the Isle of Man. Still only 22, this very pleasant young man from Reading has won 4 different championships in just 4 seasons. After 4 home victories this year, he's looking forward to shining on the world stage in his work's Subaru Legacy.
it's a very good opportunity for me to be seen by the world arena, because it is Britain's round of the world championship. All the top drivers and top teams will be coming here. And I'm in a car that's competitive enough to maybe win the rally even, so it's a good chance for me to appear to be doing well in front of everybody.
So, after a year of caution, he can really put his foot down over the next 4 days.
Alistair McRae has not had the best of years. In the British Championship, he found himself playing second fiddle to Richard Burns, thanks to a mixture of mechanical problems and driving mishaps. But he will be looking to put all this behind him on the RAC and have the little bit of luck that all drivers need on such a demanding and unpredictable event. He will certainly not wish to be overshadowed by both his big brother and his father on this unique family occasion.
Gwyndaf Evans, the likeable Welshman, has, and like Alistair, had a very good year driving the environmentally friendly Escort.
So going left into eight rights. Oh. Well done. Eight rights.
He's had his share of good fortune, but thoroughly deserved his Group N championship. Last year on the RAC rally, he finished 11th overall and could be in for a top 10 place this year.
Scotland's Robbie Head, the 25-year-old from Ayr, will be driving a powerful Group A Escort on this event. But he will probably want to forget his first season in a Group N Escort. After mechanical problems in Wales and Cumbria, he was very lucky to emerge unscathed from this high-speed off in Ulster.
Yo!
Thankfully, he is nothing if not resilient and finished a fine third in the Isle of Man. His mentor and teammate, Malcolm Wilson, has had an equally annus horribilis. Firm favourite to take the British Championship, he was on the pace, but often out of luck. As was all too often the story, a massive lead on the Scottish rally ended with mechanical failure. Last year, of course, he put up a superb performance on the RAC. He was fastest on seven stages and finished ninth on his Sierra Swansong. And, of course, no one has done more to develop the new Escort.
While Malcolm Wilson and the other rally drivers are hurtling round the course, there's a massive backup unit behind many of them, trying to keep in front of the leaders and only appearing when something goes wrong. Ford, for the British round of the World Rally Championship, have only entered one car, but there's a massive army of other vehicles right behind them. It is then the 18 vehicle Ford convoy. Now, it's an old cliche, but they say armies always march on their stomachs, and the same, you know, can be said of rally teams too. But where do you find a cup of tea in the middle of the Kielder Forest? Pamela, you have the job of looking after the stomachs of the rally team. You must find yourself in some fairly sort of isolated spots, I guess.
Yes, you do. There's quite a bit of travelling around and we end up in some most peculiar places off the beaten track.
So it's cold and wet and muddy and you get all these hungry rally team coming at you. Are they awkward? Are they tired? Do they just want food instantly or what?
No, they're never really awkward, but time is of the essence and they don't have a lot of time to mess about. So when they arrive, you have to have the food ready at that minute and you can't say, oh, I'm ever so sorry, I haven't quite made it yet. No, everything has to be done exactly to a schedule.
So the variety of food you do must be immense and you cook it all in this little unit?
Yes, I do. It's really quite small. Come and have a look.
I will. Well, here we are, very cosy.
Certainly is.
I'm amazed that you can cook so many meals on such a small stove as this.
Yes, it's actually quite difficult at times to cook so much food on only two gas rings. I do have a small microwave, but because it's very small, you can't really get very much in it.
Does the RAC present you with more problems than just about anything else?
It's quite a tough one, the RAC, because the weather's often against you. Everyone gets very cold, so people really want a lot of hot, home-cooked food. If I serve, say, 30 people at each sitting, I'm doing probably 150 meals a day. And cups of tea, people will at least drink 2 cups of tea each, and that just carries on through the day.
Now, apart from all the food needed to feed Ford's travelling army, there are literally thousands of other car parts that have to go on every rally. They like to think of it here as service with a smile. OK, lads, load up. That's it then, 576 parts in each van and 8 vans on the RAC rally for Ford. Now let's meet someone who has everyone's interests at heart. Well, Dr. Mark Porter, you're well known to television viewers, of course, and well known to everyone here at Ford as their doctor. But what's your major role, do you think?
Well, it's 2 parts, really. I'm basically a simple GP to the team, and you've got nearly 100 people going away to some of the sort of more exotic places that we go to on the World Rally Championship. Things go wrong and the team wants to be independent of local medical services. And I actually look after the drivers as well, both in their preparation and care during the event, which is an increasingly important thing in rallying.
What about the fitness side of things? Because I suppose rally drivers in the past haven't been exactly the fittest sportsmen going.
No, the average macho rally driver wouldn't be seen dead in a gym 5 years ago, but thankfully that's changed dramatically, and if you want to be world champion, you've got to put in a lot of effort. And the leads really come from Formula One, I think, where the drivers are super fit.
What kind of things go wrong? Obviously, there's a possibility of an accident, but what other niggling things happen to a rally team?
I mean, I think the accident thing is important to put in perspective. It's very, very rare, and we've never had any big problems there. But it's things like neck strains, lower back aches, but simple things like stomach upsets and things can really destroy a team's chance of winning a rally. So it's very important to have a doctor on site to get that sorted straight away.
And finally, if they do win, does the doc feel pleased as well?
Oh, yes, I get to celebrate with them as well, and many a good time has been had.
Well, John, I know people talk about F1 mechanics, but these boys have got to be just as quick, haven't they?
Indeed, they have, and the pressure's on them because they can repair the car and we can still be competitive, where in Formula One, if something mechanically goes wrong, they're out of the race.
What about the times? I mean, they're incredible, the gearbox and turbo times, aren't they?
A gearbox is 10 minutes, a turbo has been done in 8 minutes, but about 10 minutes is average. A complete suspension and all the transmissions they can do in about 40 minutes.
And they come into the service areas and it's all got to be high pressure, high skill, hasn't it, really?
High pressure, high skill, a lot of concentration, because if these guys make a mistake and something falls off the car on a stage, the driver's lost his chance. They do practice a lot, as you can see them practicing now, and they're working on the cars all the time.
By the sounds of things, that car's ready, so it's on your way, isn't it?
Yes, thank you. I must go back and get on with some testing.
Thank you. Now, as usual, the rally throws up a wide and wonderful selection of entrants from a wide and wonderful range of backgrounds.
To most of us, squeezing into an open-face helmet and donning full harness is by no means an everyday occurrence. But it's all in a day's work for 32-year-old squadron leader Simon Mead. But after 3 years with the Red Arrows, he will literally be coming down to earth on the RAC rally. The target for his team is to complete the event and at the same time to raise £20,000 for the charity Childline.
The Red Arrows do quite a lot of work for charity through the Red Arrows Trust, and I was just looking for something to do myself, to add my own little bit to it. Our aim is to raise the money for the charity, that's the prime goal. And obviously the further we go in the event, the more exposure we get, and the more money we can raise for the Childline. I think it's going to be very difficult, I mean, no illusion of that. It's not going to be a walk in the park, but you know, we've done it as professionally as we can, and we're going to give it our best shot.
If all goes well, he won't be rolling his Volkswagen like this. The Forest of Kielder will be a little less forgiving than Cumulonimbus.
On a dark winter's night in the Derbyshire town of Chesterfield, the students are all hard at it, as you'd expect. Among them, those in the Department of Automobile Engineering are, as part of their course, involved in a special project, preparing a Peugeot 205. It's an unusual operation, to say the least, for a college of education.
The most important thing was, initially, to make sure it became part of the syllabus and part of the ongoing daily life of the students, but also to involve as many students as we could from as many different departments. It needed to be a college-wide programme, not just a lads going rallying, but to get the thing ready so that lots of people could be involved, lots of people could own the idea, lots of people could own the project.
Nearly everyone at Chesterfield College has got involved in one way or another. Even the Department of Catering have joined forces to fuel the drivers and service crews on the rally. The students here have devised a special diet, including carrots, obviously for the night stages. Even the lads from the carpentry course have come on board, fitting out the borrowed service van. So far this year, they've only competed on one-day events. Do the youngsters know what lies in store?
I should imagine it's going to be very tough. 4 days, it's a long time. We've usually had enough after one day's rallying, so I don't know how we're going to go on with this time.
Be realistic, we're basically wanting to finish Bainer's first event, get as many sponsorship as we can for next season.
It's got to be a totally different approach to anything we've done before. I mean, we're more or less entering blind. Nobody's got any previous experience of that type of thing, so we know it's going to be very tough. We know cars got to be reliable and we've got to be clinical in service locations, chase car requirements, you know, everything.
At the time when the project was started, I was the Director of Education in Derbyshire, and I actually thought this would be a good idea for students in Derbyshire. I hadn't quite realised that the director would end up driving the car. But the car has stood up to the rigours of a championship for a whole year, and I'm certain now it'll actually stand up to the RAC.
Well, that's one of the nice things about this rally, the mixture between amateur and professional teams. Now, here's your chance to get involved in our coverage. Of course, we've got camera crews all over the country, but we can't be on every bend. And in years gone by, you've captured some key moments on your own video equipment. So if you think you shoot something amazing this year, please call us on this special number, 021 265 4622. That's 021 265 4622. Well, that's it from a freezing Birmingham, where the forecast is for more of the same, possibly even snow. The cars leave here at 7:30 tomorrow morning for the start of the gruelling 4-day Network Q RAC Rally. We'll see you tomorrow.